Thank you. drive a lottery number to run the lottery. We drive the lottery for the lottery. The lottery is the authority.
Everyone can please find a seat. We're ready to get started. Please be seated if you're not media or working.
Thank you.
If everyone would please rise for the invocation led by Paul Dykstra and remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance led by Kevin Flagg.
Well, you fed your bodies. Let's feed the spirit just a little bit. Heavenly Father, we're gathered here today to be a group of conservative Christian people. Lord, we just lift you up at this time. We lift up the state of Iowa and its leadership, the House and the Senate, as they endeavor to do the work of the people. Lord, we pray over the guests that are here today, some new, some old. But Lord, be with us. Be with us as we try to seek your pathway and endeavor to do the work of Jesus Christ. As we approach this Easter season, Lord, let us always remember the sacrifice that was given by your son Jesus. Lord, I pray blessings on this state and the people that work here and those that live here. You have blessed Iowa in so many ways, and we continue to ask for those blessings. As the season comes before us for planting and harvest follows, Lord, let the harvest be bountiful this year. Let the people earn and make the money that's needed. Be with them in every endeavor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome to the Westside Conservative Club on a special day. Today is National Vietnam Veterans Day, so we picked a good day to have a meeting. Let me know in back if you have trouble hearing us. Before we introduce our guests, we'd like to make a few introductions of people or recognitions of people with us in the crowd. First, I want to recognize the three folks who are co-hosts with me that help put this together every week. Brad Bousted. Ernie Rudolph. And the lady that really makes it run that you would have met with coming in with the name tags at the table, Colleen Smith. have a couple of other people that really we couldn't do this without. And one gentleman who has joined us, we haven't had him with us for a while, but Tom Clark. Tom is the one who donated our sound system, and when it's not working, it's my fault, not his. We've changed microphones, and I can't seem to adapt yet, I guess. And then also, we couldn't do this without the Machine Shed. And Mike Whalen is with us today. Mike, thank you so much. Today we have David Ullman, a past Republican Party of Iowa co-chair. Dallas County Supervisor Mark Hansen. Former GOP State Central Committee member Paul Dykstra. Congressman Zach Nunn's chief, our Iowa director, Wes Enos. Dallas County GOP chair and also a member of the Republican State Central Committee, Kelly Koch. Secretary of State, Paul Pate's Chief of Staff, Mike Ross. And Senator Grassley's Iowa Director, Carol Olson. Today's a very special day for the Westside Conservatives. We have a guest today who has been a conservative leader and kind of exemplifies the spirit of, I think, conservatism. He's dedicated his life to public service, and starting out, he was served in Congress for 12 years, ending up being the third highest position in the Republic, running the Republican Congress, the third highest position in Congress for us. Then he went on from there to become governor of Indiana. Now, that's important to me because my family came from Indiana, and I'm an eighth-generation Hoosier. I don't talk about that about the time we're having the Iowa game, but we claim it all the rest of the time. But when he was a governor, you know, he carried on his tradition of conservative activism and improvements. He gave Indiana the biggest tax cut they had ever had. He's always been a friend of Right to Life, and he continued leadership in that area. And he left for his term with a $2 billion surplus in the budget. We like that. That's good conservative principles. And he was getting ready to run for another term and was looking really good on that. And somebody gave him a call and said, hey, you know, we need your help in D.C. because it's a bigger mess in D.C. than what Indiana is. Why don't you run for vice president? And we all know how things changed drastically once his administration was in. You know, very proud of his conservative leadership. And you know, it's been a tough time right now that we're going through. I'm an attorney, as most of you know. I've had a couple classes in constitutional law, and I'm a pretty strict constructionist when it comes to that. And you know, I couldn't be more proud of the way our vice president represented us at a time when things were really tough. Not only were they tough, they were dangerous for him physically, and he stood there with his principles and back that up. And you know, and his family was even there at the time. This is really, really tough stuff. You know, a lot of people talk the talk, but when it comes down to your health, your life, your family's life, we know that you're really telling us the truth and you're sincere on it. And I'd be very, very proud to introduce our speaker, former Vice President Mike Pence.
Thank you so much.
One thing I did want to add was, long at the beginning of his career, he was asked to identify himself, and he says, one, I'm a Christian, two, I'm a conservative, three, I'm a Republican, in that order. I think his life's together, and that was done way before he had to be doing publicity pieces and stuff. But Mike, we appreciate you. You're the real thing.
Thank you so much. Join me in thanking Kim Schmidt, will you? This is, I'm deeply humbled by that overly generous introduction. And thank you for giving the shorter version of the introduction. I prefer it.
They want to hear you.
The one I prefer is I'm a Christian, a conservative, a Republican, in that order. And I guarantee you, if I lived in Iowa, I would be a member of the Westside Conservative Club, and I'd be here on time every week. I would. Thank you, Kim, for your great leadership. Thank you for the team here, all the distinguished guests who are here. And Mike Whalen, I think, I feel like Mike might be in the back of the room. Mike, thanks for all you do for the Republican cause. Thanks for your support of Westside Conservative. It really is a joy to be with all of you. And a little bit painful, a couple people at this table wanted to bring up the men's NCAA basketball tournament. I was in Iowa last weekend with Joni Ernst. It was the morning after, and I spell that M-O-U-R-N-I-N. After Purdue University went out in the first round, it was a little tough. My son and daughter-in-law are proud Boilermakers. Indiana University went out shortly after that. But how about the Hawkeye women making it to the Final Four and squaring off tomorrow night, everybody? Wishing them every success, and we'll see you next year in the Big Ten. But it is a real joy to be with all of you. It truly is. And I also, you know, I'm the proud son of a combat veteran who served in the Korean War. I'm the father of a captain in the Marine Corps serving today, and one of my unworthy son-in-laws is a lieutenant in the United States Navy. So it's a special joy to be here. I met many men and women in the room who serve in the armed forces of the United States, but especially on Vietnam Veterans Day. Let's hear it for all of our veterans, all those who served, and to our Vietnam veterans, welcome all. It really is wonderful to be with you. I appreciate you all coming out. Looking forward to hearing what might be on your mind, but I have a few thoughts to share from the outset. First and foremost, let me just pay a debt of gratitude. On behalf of my family, on behalf of the team that served around us, Iowa led the way, and I want to thank you for the privilege of serving as your vice president. It was the greatest honor of my life. Thank you, Iowa. I mean, you look at the change that we made in the life of the nation, it was truly extraordinary. And my life has changed a lot since the last time most of us were together. Karen and I moved home to Indiana. We bought 5 acres and a pond, got a cornfield right next door, oversized American flagpole out front. I bought a riding mower, John Deere, 54-inch deck, zero-turn radius, 25 horsepower. Karen actually lets me ride it. You know, one of the great things about no longer being vice president is you get to drive your own car. One of the bad parts is you get to pay for your own gas. But the greatest thing that's happened to us, I shared with this table over there, is after years of waiting and hoping and praying, in the last 2 years, our kids have delivered for us 3 of the most perfect granddaughters in the history of the world. So we're having a great time. In fact, Karen isn't with me on this trip because one of them's home. And I think the grandparents in the room can appreciate that. But little Etta Rose and our daughter Charlotte are in from California, where she and her husband are stationed, and it's just ridiculous. Now, if you're curious, Karen and I, you know, several of you addressed me by my former title. I respect that tradition. You know, I prefer Mike. But my wife's nickname as grandmother is actually Kiki. She has a license plate that says that. But my daughter-in-law told me when our first grandchild was born, my daughter-in-law told me that she said, "You're going to be Bop," which I thought was ridiculous. I looked at her. I said, "Sarah, I can't be Bop." I said, I've been vice president of the United States. I've been governor of Indiana. That's not altogether dignified. But the first time little Avery Grace looked up at me, stretched her arms out and said, "Bop." I'm Bop, if anybody asks the question. So we've been blessed beyond measure, and it was an incredible privilege to serve as your vice president during, I think, one of the four most consequential years where we put conservative principles into practice and we left America stronger and more prosperous than ever before. I mean, you know, I'm kind of reminded as I think about all that we accomplished, Kim, as we think about all that we accomplished, putting conservative principles into practice. I want to be careful not to just go on too long. I'm reminded of a pastor who started at a little church in rural Indiana. And he wanted to shake things up, so he decided to add a Sunday night service at 6 o'clock. So he put it in the bulletin, he showed up, and as the story goes, that first Sunday night, one lonely farmer showed up for that first Sunday night service. And the young pastor earnestly said to him, well, what do you think we ought to do? And the farmer said, he said, Reverend, I don't know much about preaching, I don't know much about running a church, but he said, one thing I do know, when I call my cows in to feed them and only one comes, I still feed them. Come on. So the pastor walked up. He thought there was some timeless wisdom in that. He opened up that 50-pound Bible. He got out his notes. 45 minutes later, Mike, he mopped his brow. He walked to the back of the church, stuck his hand out, said to that farmer, well, what'd you think? The farmer was holding his hat in his hand. He said, Reverend, I don't know much about running a church. I don't know much about preaching. But he said, when I call my cows in to feed them and only one comes, I don't give them the whole load. So I'm not going to give you the whole load, but think about those 4 years with the support of the people of Iowa. We rebuilt our military. We made the strongest military in the history of the world, stronger than ever before. We stood with our allies. We stood up with our enemies. Our armed forces took down the ISIS caliphate. We cut taxes, rolled back regulation. We achieved energy independence for the first time in 75 years. We secured our border. We reduced illegal immigration by 90% and with more than 300 judges on our federal courts, including Justice Neil Gorsuch, Justice Brett Kavanaugh, and Justice Amy Coney Barrett. Those three justices made up the majority that sent Roe v. Wade to the ash heap of history where it belongs and gave America a new beginning for life. It was extraordinary, all that we accomplished before that pandemic struck. And I'll always be proud of what the American people did during those difficult days to step up and come alongside one another. And I'll always be proud of your governor, Kim Reynolds, who did an incredible job for the people of Iowa during good times and bad. But my life has changed. Our lives have all changed, haven't they, since those days? I mean, when you look at the policies of the Biden administration over the last 2 years, President Joe Biden has weakened America at home and abroad. I mean, the truth is that that disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan, I believe, ultimately emboldened the enemies of freedom around the world. And it never should have happened. But let me say this from the bottom of my heart. Having traveled as a congressman, as a governor, and as a vice president to visit our troops downrange more than once, that disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan will never diminish the service and sacrifice of men and women who served in Afghanistan the last 20 years defending our nation. I promise you. But whether it be capitulation to the mullahs in Iran, whether it be early capitulation to Russia on the Nord Stream 2, you know, history teaches that weakness arouses evil. And I believe the weakness projected by this administration abroad has only been matched by the feckless leadership at home. I mean, it's incredible to think about. Virtually every challenge facing the American people today, whether it's inflation at a 40-year high, whether it's the worst crisis at our southern border in history, has caused an avalanche of fentanyl into virtually every city in our country. Whether it be crime wave in our major cities,
one issue after another, literally you can trace back to policies of this administration. I mean, Joe Biden likes to blame high gasoline prices the last 2 years on the war in Ukraine, but I promise you, gasoline prices are high because of the war on energy, and the war on energy has to be brought to an end, and we have to unleash American energy for the sake of our nation. We reduced illegal immigration by 90% under our administration by building a wall and negotiating a Remain in Mexico agreement that required people to wait outside the country as they applied for asylum. This administration literally froze construction of the wall on day one. And the president of Mexico very recently commended President Biden for not building 1 foot of border wall. Commended him as the first president in many years about which he could say that. And then, of course, runaway inflation in the country that's hurting families. I was with at a restaurant up in New Hampshire not long ago at Tempestas. It's a great little Italian restaurant. And the owner looked at me and he said, if you want to know if inflation matters, he said, eggs used to cost a nickel, now they cost 30 cents a piece. And he talked about struggling to keep people on the payroll. And people that are running restaurants, people that are running their own family budgets know what I'm talking about. I mean, the impact of inflation is real. I was at a gas station not long ago, and a mother with two small children in the back seat, I asked her how she was holding up under high gas prices and inflation, and she said, we're doing okay. She said, we only have to go to the food bank once a week. And I looked at her and said, well, are you and your husband out of work? And she said, no, he's got a job. But she said, the high prices, we don't have anywhere to go in our family budget.
And she said, fortunately, the people at the local food bank are very gentle. That's what's really going on in America today. I mean, the vast majority of American families are living paycheck to paycheck right now. And it's a direct result of the runaway federal spending of this administration. Joe Biden comes into office, and within a matter of months, he passes $2 trillion in spending that ignited the worst inflation in 40 years. And I mean to tell you, men and women, we have to turn off the gusher of spending, cut back taxes in America. We have to unleash this economy and restore fiscal discipline to Washington, D.C. And then we see the assault on our liberties and our most cherished values. The foundation I created in Washington, D.C. recently weighed in on that Lynn Mar school issue. It's just remarkable to see this radical gender ideology taking a hold in our local schools. But I want to assure you that we have a Supreme Court, once that case makes it there, that I think is going to set things right. I mean, to think about at that school, you have to bring a note in to get a Tylenol. But the school can give you a gender transition plan without ever informing your parents. And students who hold the view that, and express the view that male and female, he created them, could be sanctioned and punished, including expelled from the school. Men and women, we see an assault on our most cherished values and liberties. And now, more than ever, we need renewed Republican leadership at every level from the top down to set this nation back on a path of security and prosperity. And it's going to take all of us. But I want you to have faith. Then I'd love to hear what's on your mind. Because I believe sometimes it's just darkest before the dawn. And if there was a silver lining of having a liberal Democrat administration and liberal Democrat majorities in the House and Senate for 2 years, is we saw their agenda writ large, didn't we? More taxes, more government, less freedom, trampling on our liberties and our ideals, weakening America at home and abroad. And I think change is coming. I know the 22 elections was a disappointment for some people, but not here in Iowa. I mean, for the first time ever, every single member of the House of Representatives from Iowa is a Republican. Thank you, Iowa. Great leaders like Zach Nunn. And how about Joni Ernst and Chuck Grassley? I mean, two of the tallest trees, strongest conservative voices in the United States Senate. Men and women, we're on the verge of a comeback. And I want you to have faith. I want you to have faith in the principles of the American founding. I mean, Kim just reflected on the wisdom of our founders enshrined in the Constitution of the United States. I spoke yesterday at Liberty University, and I challenged law school graduates there to just keep faith with the wisdom at the heart of our republic, enshrined in that Constitution and expressed in the ideals of the Declaration of Independence. It's what, in large measure, brought us to be the strongest, most powerful nation in the history of the world, and it'll see us through these times if we'll simply stand firm. Stand firm on the principles and ideals from the American founding. Secondly, I want you to have faith in the American people. You know, I think our politics these days is more divided than any time in my lifetime. But I'm not convinced the American people are as divided as our politics. I mean, you get 15 miles out of Washington, D.C., the people in this country actually get along pretty well. It's true. Now, I'll be honest with you. My 20 years in public service in the Congress for 12 years, although it seemed longer, 4 years as a governor, 4 years as your vice president, my opinion of our national government went down. But my opinion of the American people went up. I mean to tell you, I've traveling to big cities and small towns, you see this is a freedom-loving nation. It's a nation of faith. It's people that are generous to a fault. I promise you, as we stand here this morning, down in Mississippi, there are absolute strangers standing in the front yard of people whose homes were devastated and possessions were destroyed. And they're giving their time and their talent and their treasure to help people that they'll never see again. I've seen our soldiers downrange by the watchfires of camps. I saw after September 11th the lines around the street blocks at every recruiting station in America as a generation responded to defend our nation in an all-volunteer army. I mean, the truth is, our challenge, men and women of Iowa, is we just got to have government as good as our people. And I believe we will. And we will soon. And finally, I'd encourage you to have that last kind of faith. You know, I really do believe that the pilgrims that stepped off on Plymouth Rock, the people that first brought came to these shores, they came to have a city set on a hill, but that wasn't a verse that they wrote. It was a verse they quoted. And from the inception of this nation has been at the center of the American experiment, the belief that we're endowed by our Creator with certain inalienable rights. And no other nation on earth was so organized. Ours has been. And I believe over the almost 250 years of our history that God has blessed America. And He will bless her still if we'll simply renew our faith in Him. And we'll continue to live out that faith toward one another. I'm absolutely convinced that someday soon we'll set things right. Someday soon we'll have government as good as our people. And someday soon, this one nation under God, indivisible with liberty and justice for all, will once again astound the world with our prosperity and our strength. So help us God. Thank you all very much. Thank you for having me to the Westside Conservative Club. It's a joy to be with you all.
Great.
Grandpa Bob, as a proud father of a captain in the United States Army, I have a philosophical...
Thank him. Thank him for me.
Her.
Wonderful.
She's in San Antonio in the medical corps. She's also served with the Army at NASA bases in Romania, right on the
Ukraine border. How about a round of applause for his daughter, everybody? Way to go, Army. Thank you.
I have a philosophical question for you. Yesterday, Frank Lutz came out with a study, and he said for the first time, because the hyper-partisanism, he is really worried about the future of the United States. Which do you think is more important, ideological purity or healing the country by really effective functional compromise?
Well, you know, I tell people I'm a conservative, but I'm not in a bad mood about it. Literally have said that for years and years from the time I was in Congress. In fact, I used to say it when I was a radio show host back in Indiana in the 1990s. And so I think there's actually a third path from what you just said. See, I think democracy depends on heavy doses of civility. I really do. And that the ability to reach principled compromise begins with respect. Showing respect to people with whom you differ on many issues, but respecting their sincerity and their desire to serve the country under the banner of their party or their own philosophy of government. I've seen it. I've seen it work that way. And I really do believe, as I travel around the country, I hear people saying two things to me all the time. Number one, they say, we got to get back to the policies of the Trump-Pence administration. Because everybody knows the Biden administration has failed America at home and abroad. But almost invariably, and maybe I hope it's some reflection of the way we've tried to carry ourselves over the years, they say, we got to get back to a threshold of respect in the public debate. That says, you can argue, I never met a liberal Democrat that begrudged me calling him a liberal Democrat. And I don't mind being called a conservative Republican, right? Accuse me of all that stuff. I'm for less taxes, less government, right? I want to take on the big issues, solve the big problems with conservative principle. But when you take it to personal attacks, I think it's different. If you read my book, So Help Me God, which I had a book come out last fall, I'm contractually obligated to mention that to you. kidding. But in the book, I talk about my own journey because I didn't always hold that view. When I started in politics, when Ronald Reagan was in the White House, I took a couple shots at elective office. I frankly allowed my ambition to overrun my Christian faith I thought required of me in the public realm. Got into some real tough personal campaigns, but I wrote about it afterwards, and when it came back around 10 years later, Karen and I determined that, you know, first thing we do is run campaigns that honor God, treat others the way we want to be treated. I think you do that, you can find a way for on some of these large, intractable issues, whether it be the debt crisis that our children and grandchildren are facing, whether it be strengthening our military and confronting a rising China and authoritarian regimes, whether it's advancing the cause of life and securing our liberties. It all begins, I believe, with having a threshold of respect that makes it possible to find principled compromise. And I believe we will.
Good morning.
Hello. Hi. Tell me your name.
My name is Cynthia.
Hi, Cynthia.
Thank you for coming to Des Moines. I'm a financial analyst by training, and I share your opinion on the origins of inflation. The question for you is, outside of energy, which I agree on your approach there, what would you specifically do to get inflation in control quickly?
Well, Cynthia, I would turn off the spigot, the gusher of spending and borrowing in Washington, D.C. I mean, we have a national debt today the size of our nation's economy, which hasn't happened since the end of World War II. And there was good reason for it then. And I will concede to you that during the Trump-Pence administration, we could have done a better job sharpening our pencils on spending. Now, during a pandemic, you know, the support that we provided to businesses, to families, to hold the country together during those times, I stand by all of it. And we'll learn the lessons from it. But apart from that, we could have done a better job. But at the end of the day, I will tell you, the best thing that we could do, not only turn off the spigot of unspent money, unleash American energy, but I think the time has come for us to have a fulsome national conversation about how we bring reforms to entitlements that are compassionate and common sense to lift the massive mountain of debt that our children and grandchildren are facing. I mean, the truth is, here's your numbers, and you're a numbers person, Cynthia. We're $32 trillion in debt right now. According to CBO, in the next 30 years, left unchecked, without reforms in Social Security and Medicare, we'll add another $120 trillion to that debt. Our nation could be facing the largest debt in 30 years the world has ever known. And there's nobody in the world that can bail us out. There's no IMF we could go to borrow money. I mean, the truth is, if we wait to deal with these issues for 25 years, the only choices will be bad. Either you actually would have to cut programs that people depend on, which you should never do, or by most estimates, you'd have to double middle-class taxes and introduce a European-style taxation system that would crush the American economy. I mean, I submit to you today, we could introduce common sense reforms for Americans under the age of 40, meaning no one in retirement today, no one that's going to retire in the next 25 years. We could phase in reforms for Americans under the age of 40 that would change dramatically that debt picture. And I think we have a moral obligation to do it. Now, some people have criticized me for saying that. Some people say it's not good politics. But, you know, I think telling the truth is always good politics. And I think the American people have a demonstrated history, when you're straight with them, to be able to do hard things. The roller sleeves up and say, okay, this is what's got to get done. And I got to tell you, last thought is, you know, looking down at Avery Grace and Elena Marie and Etta Rose, if you can look down at those little ones and say this is your problem, not ours, you're made of different stuff than me. I think we can generate leadership in the right way in this country that can introduce reforms to these programs and save our nation from a debt crisis. And I believe we will, because the American people ultimately always do the right thing. And we will for our future generations as well. So help me God.
Thank you. Mike, my name's Rich, and so help me God, I think you're on the right track.
Thank you.
And so, thinking back in my life, Roe v. Wade, I think that was one of the greatest mistakes in our history, and I appreciate your pro-life position.
Thank you.
Could you say a couple words about it? Our newly elected representative, Zach Nunn, the only position that his opponent, which I won't mention her name, had to go on was her pro-choice stance. Can you say a couple words about how that makes any sense or doesn't make any sense? Thank you.
Well, there's some people that think that standing without apology for the right to life is a negative politically, but allow me to refer you to Congressman Zach Nunn. Right, he took a stand. And all our candidates around the country who stood without apology for the right to life and expressed themselves with principle and compassion did fine. I mean, I truly do believe the vast majority of the American people understand the unalienable right to life is at the heart of who we are as a nation. I truly believe that. But with the overturning of Roe versus Wade, I said in the aftermath of that, I said, you know, we haven't come to the end of the debate over life. We just come to the end of the beginning. And it may take just as long to restore the sanctity of life to the center of American law in every state as it did to overturn Roe versus Wade. But as I said yesterday at Liberty University, I've been saying all over the country, we cannot rest, we cannot relent until we restore the sanctity of life to the center of American law. Now, for me, you know, starting out in politics, full confession here at Westside Conservative, I was a Democrat when I started out in politics. I was. I was the Youth Democrat Party coordinator in Bartholomew County, Indiana. Kind of a community organizer. But I'll tell you what, when I got to college, I started hearing the voice of this B-movie actor turned president, I suddenly started hearing the voice of my immigrant grandfather, the values of my dad, and I joined the Reagan Revolution and never looked back. But it was also time for me that I came to faith in Christ in my freshman year in college, and I opened up that book, and I read verses like, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And see, I set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live." And it was then that I knew that if I had a calling in public life, that I would have to stand for life. I would have to make his cause my cause. And by God's grace, I had the opportunity to introduce the first bill in Congress to defund Planned Parenthood. I had an opportunity to advance pro-life legislation and adoption reform in Indiana. But I have to tell you, it's however many times around the sun I've got left, I will count it a joy and a privilege to have been part of the most pro-life administration in American history that gave us a new beginning for life. So thank you for your question, and thank you for your stand. Good? Anybody else? Over here. Yes, sir, and then we'll get over there. Sir.
Ken Smith.
Hi, Ken.
My question is, how do you propose that we would solve the Social Security funding situation?
Well, I think you just got to be honest with the American people. I don't think people are talking about what we're facing today. I threw those numbers out. But if you fast forward to $150 trillion in debt, that means every single man, woman, and child in America owes about $500,000. And it's utterly unsustainable in the country. And I guarantee you, there's a whole lot of liberals in Washington, D.C. who understand this clearly, and they know that the only thing Washington, D.C. would do in 25 years is raise taxes. And Mike's nodding his head back there. You know what I'm talking about. I mean, you'll hear the tax cut for the rich thing, or excuse me, the tax increase the rich and make them pay their fair share routine. You know, you could take every penny from every billionaire in America, and that's about $5 trillion. And we're going to be about $150 trillion short. It's just that simple. It's math. They will come hard at the middle class. They'll come hard at small business. And you will have a European-style taxation system that will crush the vitality out of this economy. So it begins by being straight with the American people. Secondly, I think it begins by what we started off the conversation with. I think you create an environment where men and women of goodwill on both sides of the aisle are willing to sit down and actually talk the thing out, figure it out. And finally, I think you take the moral case to the American people. You stop all this nonsense about making people on Social Security that got hair the same color as me, right? Make them worried. No, I'm not going to touch anybody that's on Social Security or anybody that's going to go on Social Security or Medicare in the next 25 years. Not going to touch it. But for younger Americans, you could give them choices. I mean, this notion of personal savings accounts that's been proposed, there's other common sense and compassionate reforms that I guarantee you, my kids who are, 31, 30, and 29 right now, if you press them to the wall, they'd probably tell you they don't believe they're going to get a penny out of Social Security. And so you can bring about reforms that will preserve the system, give more choices to younger Americans. But I think, Ken, it really all begins with being straight with the American people and not pretending anymore. Maybe this was a harder sell when we had $5 trillion in debt, but when you have debt the size of your economy, for the first time since World War II, I think maybe the American people might be ready for an honest conversation. And I'll be a part of it, I promise you, one way or the other. Yes, sir. Here and the, oh, she's over here, yes.
Thank you, Vice President. As you know, Iowa is the new border state in fentanyl.
Right.
Interstate I-35 from south to north, and then the bullseye, I-80 east to west. So we've got an uptick. Over 420 Iowans are dead. Fentanyl overdose. I'm inviting you to the April 13th fentanyl crisis event. Specifically, what would you do? Because all roads to fentanyl are leading to the Biden disaster at the border states.
Well, first off, thanks for your leadership on this issue. We're just not talking about it enough. I mean, we talk about 5 million people have come across our border in the last 2 years, avalanche of humanity, and they're suffering on both sides of the border and hardship. But we're not talking about the fentanyl issue. I mean, people need to understand the cartels have operational control of our border right now. And that's an exact quote that I have heard standing on the border with green shirt wearing Border Patrol agents. They will tell you, look, we chase it every day, but these guys set the rules. And people forget it's not just human trafficking at an unimaginable pace, but they use and exploit vulnerable people that they haul up the peninsula, and some of them make it, some of it don't. They don't really care. And young women particularly, Doctors Without Borders will tell you, are abused in record numbers. It's unspeakable stuff. But not only is that happening, but they use the human trafficking to move drugs across the border in other places, underground or overground. And the system has just been overwhelmed. So the first thing you do is you build a wall, you close the border, you reinstitute remain in Mexico, and you get control of the southern border the way we had under the Trump-Pence administration. You just do it. And secondly, you got to play hardball with the Mexicans. I negotiated the remain in Mexico agreement along with Secretary of State Mike Pompeo. And so I know how they respond, okay? I mean, this is a true story if you want to know how you get control of the border. We'd for 2 years been trying to negotiate a deal where if you applied for asylum, you'd wait on the other side of the border, right? This makes common sense. Not you apply for asylum and then disappear into the country and 95% never show up for their asylum hearing a year and a half later. So it's just common sense. So we were in the Oval Office, true story. I'm sitting next to the Resolute desk. And the president has the whole team, the whole Homeland Security team, border team in front of him. He goes, how come we don't have remain in Mexico yet? And they said, well, the Mexicans said we got to take time. We got to get work on it. We got to make it happen. It's going to take time to do it. And the president says, will you tell them if they don't get it done in 2 weeks, I'm going to tariff everything at the border by 5%. And then 2 weeks later by 10%. And 2 weeks after that by 15%. And his team sat there and looked at him kind of startled. And then he said, you know what, forget it. And he pulled his phone out and started typing. True story. Hit send and said it in a tweet to, 150 million people. He looked at me and he said, Mike, I need you to go get with the Mexicans tomorrow and tell them what my position is. I said, I bet they already know. And then he says to Pompeo, he goes, you go with Pence, you get with the Mexicans, you tell them it. So I sat down, true story, here's how it ended out. There's a little bit of I write about in my book about obviously it did not end well. But all those 4 years, the president and I had a very good working relationship, bringing different talents, oftentimes different temperament to things. But we both understood each other, we were both working the same agenda, right? So he says to me, you go talk to the Mexicans. So I had them all in the next day in the Roosevelt Room in the West Wing. Big battery, the foreign minister for Mexico, the ambassador, all the economic people, true story. And they all came with charts and graphs and, I mean, really nice PowerPoint stuff. They said, here, we can't do it. It's going to be, many months before we could do remain in Mexico. I let them talk for about 25 minutes. And I said, okay, so, right, you can't do it, right? No, we just can't do it. I said, are you done? They said, yeah. And I said, well, I can make this pretty short. And they said, what? And I said, he really means it. And they said, he means what? And I said, he means what he said yesterday. I said, look, I've worked with this guy for several years. I mean, we're done. I mean, he's going to do what he said in that tweet. So, and the guy said, well, that would destroy our economy. And I said, it wouldn't do any good for ours. But I said, maybe we should just figure this thing out. And sure enough, 36 hours later, we had a signed agreement, remain in Mexico, went into effect and reduced asylum abuse and illegal immigration by 90%. That's what you got to do. Okay? We got to look at the Mexicans in the eye and say, you know what? You got to put your National Guard on the border. We're securing our border again. But you got to stop this fentanyl flow into our country. It's killing people. I haven't been in a state in this country in the last 2 years where when I stand together with law enforcement, they just say, the first word out of their mouth is what you're championing here in Iowa, is challenging that fentanyl issue. But it begins with border security. Strong law enforcement at home can deal with it, but we got to cut off the spigot. So God bless you for what you're doing, really and truly. Yes, sir. Got a few more minutes, I think. Are we okay? Kim, are we okay? Great.
Tom O'Brien.
Hi, Tom.
One thing that concerns me greatly is if we want to accomplish the hopes and dreams and goals that we all talk about, we need to do something about the Republicans in name only and conservatives in name only. How about some suggestions along that line?
Well, I remember the term RINO used to apply to Republicans that voted with the Democrats, right? You know, that's what we called them. When I was in Congress, I actually battled against the big spenders in my own party. You can read about it in my book. I don't know if I mentioned I have a book out. But I was a thorn in the flesh to the Bush administration because I took on what I called big government Republicanism. You know, when they brought this massive prescription drug entitlement, expanding entitlements, I led the fight against it. I led the fight against the Wall Street bailout, according to most Americans, in the Congress at the time. And it's just because I believe in limited government. I believe in the principles enshrined in the Constitution. We talked a minute ago about education. I believe education is a state and local function, that we ought to shut down the federal Department of Education and block grant every single penny back to Iowa and every state in the country to innovate in education the way you are here. And again, I want to give another shout out to Governor Kim Reynolds and your state legislature. Thank you for extending educational choice to every family in Iowa. It's going to change lives for generations. So to me, it's all about being willing to let your yes be yes and your no be no. It's just to stand up for conservative principles. There's a lot of people that, a lot of people in Washington, D.C. right now are talking about defense spending. And I'm all about it. You just heard me say I want to take on the national debt. But Joe Biden's budget actually includes roughly a 1% cut in defense spending. At a time that China's dropping a new ship into the Pacific Ocean every month, at a time that Russia's on the move in Ukraine, and authoritarian regimes around the world have been emboldened by the weakness shown in this administration. This is not the time to cut spending in defense, I promise you. But I believe that if you look at that preamble of the Constitution, you get your to-do list. To provide for the common defense, for those of us that believe in a constitutional republic, that's the first obligation of the government. So to me, the challenge that we have going forward is to really continue to elect men and women that will stand without apology for the principles of limited government, for a strong national defense, for traditional values without apology. And I have to tell you, I believe we are. I believe there's a whole new generation rising around the country standing up for that. But it's all about, mainly it's all just about keeping faith with the American founding and the principles there. That's what the Republican Party is. But I love your question. Time for one or two more? One more. Good. Yes, sir, please. There you go, Terry.
And we're just talking about the our economic problems and our debt problems.
Yes, sir.
And about our border problems. What's your take and position on all the money that we are sending to Ukraine to protect their borders? Even though we have compassion for the Ukraine citizens, what's your opinion on that?
Terry, and I admire your compassion, I do. But this might be one where you and I agree to disagree, and that's okay. But Ronald Reagan in 1985, in his State of the Union address, describe what came to be known as the Reagan Doctrine, which was, in his day, it said, if you're willing to fight the communists in your country, we'll give you the means to fight them there so we don't have to fight them here. And I believe the United States of America must continue as the leader of the free world, as the arsenal of democracy. The United States of America must continue to give the Ukrainian military what they need to repel the Russian invasion. I believe it with all my heart. Now, I think some of the waning support that we see for that basic principle, which is a time-honored American principle, is a reflection of the lack of confidence in President Biden's leadership. And I understand that. But I will tell you that the idea that we have to choose between being the leader of the free world and standing with courageous fighters in Ukraine and solving the problems here at home, like securing our border, reviving our economy, unleashing American energy, we can do both. And people that think we can't do both have a fairly small view of the greatest nation on earth. I hold the view that we can do both. We just have to have leadership that will demonstrate the ability to do it. And last thought, just on Ukraine, just to give you food for thought, and a very respectful question. I appreciate it, Terry. I've met Vladimir Putin. I've stood me to you with him. I've told him things he didn't want to hear. Anybody that thinks that Vladimir Putin will stop if he takes Ukraine has, as we say back in Indiana, another think coming. He moved against the country of Georgia under the Bush administration. He grabbed Crimea under the Obama administration. Now he's rolled the tanks. Ours is the only administration in the 21st century where Russia did not attempt to redraw international lines by force. And that's because we increased defense spending by the largest amount since the days of Ronald Reagan, and we allowed our military to take the fight to our enemies on our terms, on their soil. And I think Russia knew. Russia knew we meant business on the world stage. That's what we need in this moment. As I said, I've mentioned a couple of these great veterans here. My son flies F-35s. My son-in-law flies F-18s. Ukraine is not our war, and we should never send American forces there. But freedom is our fight. And if they're willing to make freedom's fight, reclaim their sovereignty, drive back Russian aggression, I think that's not just in Ukraine's interest. I think it's in the interest of the United States and the West. I truly do. But thank you for the question.
Thank you so much for coming here, being with us today. We hope we see a lot of you in the next couple of months. And, you know,
I think you're the first ex-vice president that we've ever had speak to the Westside Conservatives, and we're hoping that you may be the first president to speak to us. So good luck.
Thank you, Tim. I promise to keep you posted. Thank you all very much. God bless you all.